Awe. Wasakahika jaja apri. Wasainika shi apri. Wajaja apri. Wapaniketh thaha. Wapamaja thaha. Nikashika apa. The people whose abode was in the heavens assembled so they might meditate upon the means by which they would descend to the earth to come into bodily existence. These are some of the words passed down on the prairies from Ohio to Oklahoma, centuries of retelling the origin story of the people to whom I belong. My name is Rodrigo Córdova Rosado. I'm a member of the Bear Clan, a citizen of the Osage Nation. I was born and raised on my home island of Puerto Rico, and my communities, like all peoples, seek to understand how they fit into the history of the universe. How many of you have ever looked up at the stars on a moonless night and wondered, how do we fit in between all the twinkling? Humans have been trying to answer these questions for as long as our eyes have looked up. Generations have passed on the knowledge that our cells, our bodies, the air in our lungs did not begin on the Earth, but rather are the result of billions of years of cosmic history, with matter being reshaped inside stars and around black holes, so we arrive at the oxygen we breathe and the iron in our blood. But in order to understand how our planet came to be around our Huitzilcomi, el Sol, our sun, we must first go further back and understand how our galaxy, the Milky Way, formed. After all, we are all descendants of the cosmically curious, and our questions have only just begun. As part of the celestial quest for answers, scientists today are trying to answer some of the most pressing questions of how the fundamental properties of our universe may be explored. Things like the origin of supermassive black holes, the things at centers of galaxies that keep them spinning. How dark matter determines where things form and how the structure of the universe works. I remember the first time I ever heard words like dark matter, black holes. I was so lost, I might as well have been orbiting Jupiter for all I knew. But today is about giving you all a peek behind the curtain of how the scientific community is asking these questions, how we're trying to understand our mysterious and wondrous universe. Since the mid-20th century, we've been on the hunt to try to understand this mysterious component of the universe called dark matter. As far as we can tell, it's the thing that is making sure that galaxies, even when they're spinning so fast that they should be ripped apart, they stay together. As far as we know, it's also what determines where galaxies form. To better illustrate this, let's think about the universe as an infinite archipelago of islands and ocean. Dark matter is the invisible ocean on which all these island galaxies sit. It forms the connective tissue that connects them all, like waves passing from shore to shore. Some islands will form close together, creating the conditions for waves to crash and foam on the surface, while other islands will be formed more isolated and have barely any waves hitting them. It's from this density of islands, from the amount of sea foam that bubbles on their surface, that we can interpret how much ocean there is around these islands, these galaxies. To put it into perspective, for every bit of atomic matter like you or I that exists in the universe, there is 5 times as much dark matter out there. If we ever hope to understand the origins of our island galaxies, of our universe, we must make sure that we get as much information as we can from dark matter and use that to understand the galaxies in which we live. Every time I look at this picture, I'm just blown away. Look at that. Galaxies, as far as the eye can see, billions of stars inside every single one of them, even more worlds that we have yet to know. In order to find out more about the role of dark matter plays in our universe, scientists found this interesting technique called the clustering statistic. By measuring the density of galaxies on the sky, we're able to understand how many are there relative to our expectations for a random distribution. This effect of clustering, galaxies coming close together, is fundamentally an effect of gravity. where dark matter is acting as an additional component to the total gravitating matter in the universe. As much dark matter as there is, it pulls galaxies close together, forming these clusters. Clustering works by this process called pair counting, where we take the positions and distances of all the galaxies in our patch of the sky and count them up, see how far away they are from each other, and compare the distribution of all the distances from all the galaxies to each other to that of a completely uniform background, a completely uniform universe. And we can clearly see from our observations that they're not random. Gravity has a role. We combine that information with our knowledge so far of dark matter, as little as it may be in the grand scheme of things, and use it to interpret how much clustering, how much clumpiness there is in the universe, and match it to our expectations from our understanding of dark matter. By measuring the actual statistic of how much clumpiness there is, combining that with our understanding of dark matter, we can understand how much dark matter we need to match the observations and effectively weigh the galaxies, to know the mass, the total mass around them. This is really important for some of the work that my colleagues and I are thinking about, because we want to understand a peculiar kind of galaxy called a quasar. Quasars are galaxies that have an active galactic nucleus at their center. They're so bright that the center is brighter than all the stars in that galaxy combined. Think of that. That's more than 10 billion stars on average. Think of this, returning to our archipelago metaphor, think of this as an eruption, a volcanic eruption in the center of our island. These active galactic nuclei, or AGN, as astronomers like to call them, are the result of intense periods of matter falling onto the supermassive black hole at the center of galaxies. As it falls in, it heats up because of friction and glows like metal in a furnace. We think quasars, like dark matter, are an integral component of the history of the universe, to understanding how galaxies form all across the sky. And nowadays, we have more questions than ever. Not only do we want to know how black holes impact the formation of galaxies, James Webb Space Telescope has uncovered many, many more galaxies that we have yet to see before. This is an observation from James Webb, released a few years ago, and all these galaxies, some of them, are from the earliest period in the universe we have observed today, from 10 or 12 billion years ago. That was James Webb's initial science goal: find these galaxies and see what else we can learn from them. By doing this, James Webb is looking into the past, imaging what these galaxies looked like so long ago, near the beginning of the universe. As these observations came and scientists got to read them, we learned more and more that some of these are incredibly bright, galaxies that break our conventions of how much brightness we expected. Many of them likely have quasars, these hot, dense centers at the core near the black hole, but with atypical characteristics, features that we wouldn't have naively expected. And we want to try to better understand, do we even know how these galaxies are being formed? Do we have to update our picture of the evolution of the universe? This gave our team an idea. We can't do the kinds of clustering techniques that we've described a minute ago on these early galaxies. We have far too few of them, and they're so far away and very difficult to detect. However, we do have populations of galaxies, of quasars, from about 7 billion years ago, a little bit closer, a little bit. And we can try these techniques on those galaxies to better understand the properties of those even further away and back in time. Think of this like a family scrapbook. You're flipping through the pages and you want to know where you fit in to your family story. You go back through the pages and find pictures of yourself as a child in high definition, vibrant colors taken on digital cameras, if you're as young as me anyways. But as we flip the pages some more, we find our parents' pictures taken on film, a little grainy. The colors might have faded a little bit, but we can see it clearly. We can see what our parents were like when they were young. But as we go back even further to our grandparents' pictures, the edges are getting damaged. The images are faded. The colors are getting dull. That's the opportunity we have with these measurements that are in between the early universe and today. We want to understand the history of our earliest ancestor galaxies by learning as much as we can from other generations. In so doing, hopefully we learn a little bit more about ourselves, about how we came to be on this galaxy at this time. Specifically, we want to make sense of quasars, these particularly interesting galaxies that have a relationship between their black hole and the formation and evolution of the galaxy. And in particular, we really care about understanding the two distinct types of quasars, red and blue. For decades, we've thought that these different types of quasars are the same object, but seen from different angles. If you have a galaxy that's blue, maybe it's because you're seeing it face on. If it's red, maybe you're seeing it edge on. This is the same process as if you had something like, say, a flashlight, and you tried to look at it, the light straight on, or if you tried to see it as the light passed through your fingers. What we're trying to do is understand how these AGN form, and if in fact they are distinct galaxy types, or are they something more interesting? Is there something more to the story than just angles? So what did we do? We took images from the Hypersuprime camera atop Mauna Kea, Hawaii, to have information from millions of galaxies scattered all throughout time and space. From these galaxies, we measured their positions, their distances, and their brightnesses, and identified those galaxies that have quasars. We further go to those galaxies that have quasars and split them again. We find the blue and the red. From these blue and red quasars, we go back and apply the same technique we've been talking about this whole time. We measure the total amount of dark matter around them by finding their clustering, their clumpiness, how much gravity has pulled them together. From our measurements, we start to learn a little bit more about how these galaxies are arranged. Are they more massive or less massive dark matter archipelagos? Our preliminary findings are these. Blue quasars, those ones here on the left, are in dark matter halos, what astronomers like to call these archipelagos we've been talking about, that are 5 times more massive than the total amount of dark matter around red quasars. This is already giving us a new picture into understanding how these different types of quasars may be forming. Perhaps there's an evolutionary sequence. Perhaps we can use this to better understand the galaxies that are even further away in time. Perhaps we can start deciphering the clues that the universe is leaving us. Studies like ours are helping us better understand the development of galaxies. And maybe we'll start learning a little bit more about the cosmic history that we all come from. As we seek to learn more about how our galaxy evolved, we are implicitly asking how we got here. From infinitely complex atoms and molecules, we have become even more nuanced organisms that now spend their time pondering the motions of dancing dots on the sky. How stars gave rise to our atoms, how we are part of the universe, how we fit in between all the twinkling. Nikashika Apa, the people whose abode was in the heavens, meditated, assembled so they might meditate upon the means by which they would descend to the earth to come into bodily existence. And it is our duty to know how we came to be on this mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam, as Carl Sagan so affectionately called our Earth. Thank you very much.